married partners and mates, and generally get together to do all the things that large numbers of people need to do.
But how these ancient people managed to build something as large as the Ring of Brodgar without modern tools or lifting equipment is astounding. Just to dig the ditch surrounding it meant excavating 11,000 tons of rock, enough to fill two Olympic-sized swimming pools. Such a construction project must have involved every able-bodied islander over a long period of time. But even more perplexing is why they built it and what this circle represented.
The fact that this is a circle of stones is incredibly significant because around about 5,000 years ago, the people of the British Isles became fascinated by round shapes. Possibly it's simply that by then they could see the horizon, because the horizon is a natural circle if you look around, and these monuments could be matching the horizon, mirroring the land around.
The Ring of Brodgar may have been built as a model of the Orkney landscape. The stones were brought from sites all over the island, and it's possible that each small community erected their own stone to represent their village. Today, only 27 remain. But experts believe it once looked like this. 60 large standing stones were surrounded by a deep ditch. Beyond the ditch rose a 10-foot high earthen bank that enclosed the whole site. The Ring of Brodgar would have sent a powerful message down through the generations that this land belonged forever to the builders and their descendants. And evidence suggests the pagans of Orkney had a very close connection to their dead. The tombs they built were entranceways to a forgotten underworld. Fifty years ago, a farmer on Scotland's Orkney island of South Ronaldsay was digging in a mound close to clifftops when he uncovered an entrance into a dark subterranean chamber. What he found staring back at him was 30 human skulls. When the tomb was excavated, the remains of a staggering 342 people were found, but not one of them was a single complete skeleton. Someone or something had scattered the remains around the tomb. Trying to figure out what, Ronald Hutton enters the burial chamber.
Getting into this tomb is difficult, dirty, but uncomfortable, and that's the way it was designed. You have to crawl, you have to bow your head in humility and enter a different world.
Once inside, the tomb opens out into a narrow room with a large chamber at each end and smaller side chambers down at floor level. Piles of assorted bones and rows of skulls were found here. Ronald believes it's evidence that the pagans often returned to handle the bones of their ancestors.
Probably people would have brought a light, but it seems that they might not have done so, that have collided with the dead in the dark, and at best that have had this eerie glow revealing one skull, one long bone after another. And you're making contact with the dead very intimately, very physically. I'm almost literally on noses being rubbed in death.
But why would the local people feel such a compelling need to be close to their dead? The answer appears to lie in the young age at which so many died. Studies of the bones have revealed that very few of the dead were over 25.
Most of the people in this population would be children and adolescents. They'd be desperately reliant upon oral tradition, whispers, tales of what had happened before, to have any sense of continuity, because actual experience, lived history, for the people in this tomb is very, very short indeed, which means the power of the dead is all the greater.
The lack of complete bodies means that the skeletons may have been broken apart and stripped of their flesh before being brought into the tomb. Clues to how this might have been done lie among the human remains, sea eagle skulls and talons. It seems likely that eagles were an integral part of the pagan death rituals that took place here.
Now this could be that when the bodies were laid out after death, they were picked clean by these huge birds. Certainly, the bones were clean when they were brought into the tomb. And this is so that the bones can be handled, can be used in ceremonies, in rituals, or it could even be the eagle as the symbol of the entire community down here on this island. They were the people of the eagle.
Today, this burial place is known as the Tomb of the Eagles, but when it was built, it was probably as much a temple as a grave.
One of our problems in studying the Neolithic is what we call these places. We call them tombs, but in the modern sense, that has to be wrong, because they are the temples of the time, they are the holy places. And it could be that the dead themselves were transmitters. So you use their bones rather like mobile phones to contact the goddesses and the gods. And only through the dead can you gain access to the other world.
We can now rebuild the Tomb of the Eagles as it was when pagan tribesmen came here to commune with their dead. Divided into three sections by upright flagstones built into the walls, at either end of the tomb were compartments, one of which was full of human bones. The chambers in the western end of the tomb held dozens of skulls, and still more lined the walls beside piles of bones. And placed among the human remains were the bones and skulls of sea eagles. The only way in or out of the tomb was through the long, narrow entranceway.
Back to the world of the living, and it's so bright.
But the Tomb of the Eagles is not the only example of a pagan burial site in the Orkney Islands. 20 miles north is a place which holds yet more secrets about the death rites and religion of the pagan islanders, the magnificent sandstone tomb of Maes Howe. Archaeologist Erica Goodman investigates.
This place is amazing. And one of the things that really strikes me to begin with is just how fine the masonry is. Remember at Scarabray, it was quite coarse. It was just little slabs of stone straight off the beach. You know, some of them were even rounded beach pebbles. But here it's all carved. You can see the masonry marks where they're actually carving this into a nice, neat block.
Maes Howe is the largest tomb on Orkney. Built some 5,000 years ago, it's made of huge Orkney flagstones, some weighing an incredible 30 tons. Approximately 15 feet square, with smaller side chambers in the middle of the walls to the left, right, and rear of the tomb, its floor plan mirrors the houses of Scarabray.
This is about a similar sort of size and shape to the houses at Scarabray. And not only that, but when you walk into the tomb here, there's a focal point here, right where the dresser would have been in the house. Also, you've got these chambers to either side in the same place as the bed has been in the house at Scarabray. Of course, the one thing that's missing is the fireplace.
The similarities between the tomb of Maes Howe and the houses of Scarabray are further evidence that the pagans of Orkney believed in a special closeness between the world of the dead and the world of the living. Another central aspect of pagan religion was the cycle of the seasons. Pagan means country dweller, and their dependence on the land meant that pagans were very aware of their place in the natural world. They attributed special significance to turning points in the seasons. They attached great importance to the summer and winter solstices, when the longest and shortest days of the year occur, as well as to the spring and fall equinoxes, the 2 days of the year when day and night are of equal length. Evidence of this can be seen in the tomb at Maes Howe. It is deliberately designed to mark one of these key seasonal events.
On Midwinter Day, which is the winter solstice, the sunlight comes straight down this passageway and it shines on the back of the tomb. The Neolithic engineers designed this on purpose in order to capture the moment of the winter solstice. And that's because in pagan thinking, the solstices are very important.
For the pagans, midwinter was the time of the dead, the season when fields were barren and no crops grew. The winter solstice marks the end of winter. By bringing its light into the tomb, the pagans were seeking the help of the ancestors, hoping to ensure the return of spring. But to capture the light of the midwinter sun, the builders of Maze How needed to perfectly align the entrance tunnel of the tomb. The four large pillars at the corners of the chamber hold a clue. The pillars are an enigma. They offer no structural support to the tomb, suggesting their purpose may lie in their close resemblance to standing stones. Local archaeologist Martin Carruthers believes that the four stones could be part of a ring of standing stones that once stood outside the tomb.
It may well be that there's a series, or have been a series, of stones here present.
But what it was actually used for has perplexed generations of researchers and sightseers. Now, a team of experts will reveal what Stonehenge looked like at its height and investigate a new theory of why it was built. They want to find out if Stonehenge was part of a much larger, now forgotten, ceremonial complex that formed a gateway to the land of the dead. Archaeologist Erica Goodman has uncovered a first clue, evidence that death rituals were being performed on the site of Stonehenge 5,000 years ago, long before the stones arrived.
When you first come to Stonehenge, the first thing you see, obviously, are this magnificent set of stones. But in fact, the earliest feature here, the very first thing to be built, was this little low bank and ditch, and it seems to have a ritual sort of usage. And we know this because in the ends of the ditches, we find important little caches of things, like whole cattle skulls or whole pots and things.
Many archaeologists believe that the pagans associated cattle skulls like those found in the ditch with death. And excavations at Stonehenge have shown that the site was being used for cremation ceremonies before the stones were raised. The first stones to arrive were the blue stones brought from the Preseli Hills in Wales, more than 200 miles away. A place which archaeologist Mike Pitts believes held special significance for the pagans.
This is really one of the great wonders of the ancient world. I mean, they don't look very big, but there is nowhere, anywhere in the world where people have, with this level of technology and this long ago, have gone so far to bring rocks to a ritual site. We have to imagine that there was something about the place these stones came from that gave them a magic power, a significance at this ritual religious location. Now, one of the things that obviously comes to mind is if we look that direction, which is where they came from, which is where Wales is, we're also looking towards the setting sun. So it may be that there's a symbolism involved with the dead and ancestors, and we're looking in the direction of where the ancestors live, where the sun goes at night.
Bringing the blue stones from Wales provided Stonehenge with a symbolic link to the world of the dead. And then, 200 years after they arrived, something extraordinary happened. Stonehenge went through a vast rebuilding program. The blue stones were rearranged and surrounded by a protective circle of massive stones called sarsens. Meanwhile, just a few miles away, a near identical henge was being built to the same plan, out of timber. There were now two henges, one of stone, the other of wood. The original wood henge has long since rotted away, but the precise location of its 168 timber posts is now marked by stout pillars of concrete.
You've got well over 100 posts, great tall oak stumps. It would almost feel like an artificial forest. The posts themselves are important, so maybe some of them had bark on, maybe some of them were carved, some of them were painted, decorated. They might have had things hanging from them.
Using data archaeologists have gathered from the site, it is now possible to recreate Woodhenge as it would have looked to the pagans who worshipped here over 4,000 years ago. The pattern of posts and the size of the circle at Woodhenge bears close resemblance to Stonehenge, and the site is also surrounded by a ditch and a bank. But a major clue to Woodhenge's significance is that the entranceway is aligned with the midsummer sunrise.
It's essential, I think, to imagine that there's some symbolic meaning in that. And we have the cattle skull and death associated with the megalith, and so perhaps the wooden posts are more to do with life. And wood is dead.
For the pagans, wood was living and warm, like the flesh-covered body. Stone was cold and hard, like the cold, hard bones of the long dead. It seems likely that Woodhenge stood for life, Stonehenge for death. A ceremonial way links Woodhenge to Stonehenge, and historian Ronald Hutton believes it may once have been used for elaborate funeral processions. The pagans would have set off from Woodhenge in the direction of the rising sun and then traveled along the nearby River Avon en route to Stonehenge.
Water, like the River Avon here, was really important to Neolithic monuments. It's found around so many of them, perhaps because it's such a strange element. It connects people and it separates them. It preserves life and it takes it away. It creates and destroys. And perhaps this essence of death and life is exactly what these monuments were about.
The procession followed the river until it reached the avenue, a ceremonial roadway that runs up to Stonehenge. Very little of the avenue survives today, but Ronald believes it may once have been lined by standing stones.
We don't know exactly what the processional avenue leading to Stonehenge looked like. It was ploughed out too long ago. But it's just possible it may have looked like this one, not far away, at Avebury. However it did appear, it would have had the function of any processional way in any religion to enable human beings to pass from a world mostly concerned with human beings to one mostly concerned with the supernatural.
Before reaching its destination, the avenue turns sharply to the west, deliberately approaching Stonehenge in the direction of the setting sun. Having started at Woodhenge at sunrise, it seems likely the funeral procession was timed to reach Stonehenge at sunset. And here, the pagan Britons would have celebrated the passing of the newly dead into the world of the ancestors. Work at the site of Stonehenge stretched over millennia, but its stone circle was built in only a few short years. Over the centuries, many of the stones have fallen or been removed, but we can now rebuild Stonehenge as it would have looked to the pagans who likely used it for their death rituals millennia ago. At the center of the ring was a horseshoe of five trilithons, two large stones with a lintel atop them. They surrounded 19 small blue stones and were in turn surrounded by the famous circle of massive sarsen stones topped by a continuous ring of gently curved lintel stones. Stonehenge and Woodhenge together would have dominated the local landscape. But only a few miles to the north is another pagan monument that has long defied all explanation, a vast artificial hill that archaeologists estimate took 18 million man-hours to construct, Silbury Hill.
In the solar system.
A few miles to the north of Stonehenge is Silbury Hill, the largest prehistoric mound in Europe. Created by pagan Britons nearly 4,500 years ago, it rises to over 120 feet and is older and higher than some of the Egyptian pyramids. But like the pyramids, does it contain a secret within?
One of the things that people always associate with big old mounds is buried treasure. And people have looked for treasure in Silbury Hill for hundreds of years. But that's the twist. There have been so many tunnels dug into this hill by now that have found not a scrap of anything you could call treasure.
Despite centuries of digging, no burials or treasure have ever been found. Silbury Hill seems to be just a solid mound of chalk and earth. The mystery of why it was built remains unsolved, but how it was built may offer clues.
This would have been an incredible technological achievement for the people of the Neolithic period. They had no metals to work with, so all of their digging was done with antler picks, and the scapulas, the shoulder blades of cows that they used for shovels.
Archaeologists calculate it would have taken 700 men 10 years to excavate, dump, and shape the 9 million cubic feet of earth and chalk that make up the hill. It was probably built in two phases.
When this was first built, it was only about 18 feet high. But then in the second phase of building, they built it up to 120 feet. So it's absolutely massive. And the slope is really steep. So it stands out in sharp contrast to the low rolling hills all around it.
But making a hill is no small challenge.
You couldn't actually build a structure like this by just piling up soil and rubble, because it would just erode down the slope. So it's very carefully engineered in order to retain this particular conical shape.
Silbury Hill may not be truly circular, but could have been built as a polygon, possibly of nine sides. Outer walls of chalk lent inwards at an angle of 60 degrees for maximum stability. They were joined by radial walls built out from the center of the mound. The gaps between were filled with chalk rubble. It's possible that the mound was built as a series of stepped platforms, but the latest archaeological surveys suggest a different method of construction.
Another thing that occurs to me is that it may have been built as a spiral. Now, there's some archaeological evidence for the construction of this mound in a spiral, and it certainly strikes me as I'm walking up that that might have been the easiest way to build it, because certainly it is easier to bring material, construction material, up a ramp than up steps.
A spiral shape may also have had religious significance.
The spiral is one of the great artistic symbols of the age. And so people taking a spiral path to the top of Silbury would be literally walking a spiral.
A spiral pathway would have made the hill both easier to build and more suitable for religious processions. But there may also be a link between Silbury and the surrounding landscape, which could explain why the structure was built so tall. Nearby is the largest stone circle in the world, Avebury. Silbury Hill is also close to two other key pagan sites, West Kennet Long Barrow and the Sanctuary. Historian Ronald Hutton wants to investigate a new theory that Silbury Hill could have been used as a signaling platform to coordinate simultaneous ceremonies at all the different sites. It's an idea that's never been tested. Until now.
Right, the theory is that from every major part of the Avebury landscape, you should be able to see the top of Silbury Hill.
To put the theory to the test, archaeologist Erica Goodman travels to West Kennet Long Barrow. The barrow once contained the remains of around 50 people and is one of the best preserved mounds in the British Isles. It's also one of the largest. It's as long and half as wide as a football field.
Well, here we are at West Kennet Long Barrow. Now let's see if we can see Ronald. Yep, there he is. You can see him keeping the red flag flying.
Next stop is the sanctuary. Probably once a forest of wooden posts, the sanctuary was not so much a structure as a ritual site where newly felled trees were ceremonially planted into the ground.
Well, here we are at the sanctuary, and I can just make out Ronald silhouetted against the sky. And that's kind of interesting, because if Silbury Hill were just a little bit lower, he'd be lost against the hills in the background. But as it is, we can see him quite clearly.
The last stop is Avebury, the largest stone circle in the world. A giant ring of 98 huge stones enclosing two smaller circles. It's likely to have been the most important ritual site in the area. For the theory to work, the flag on Silbury Hill should be visible, but inside the ring, it isn't. Only when Erica climbs the circle's high outer bank does all become clear.
From the top of the bank here, I can see him quite clearly. And in fact, he's silhouetted against the sky again. And you can see Sobry Hill is standing up against the skyline, higher than the level of the surrounding hills. So Ronald's theory really does work. Maybe it could be a signaling platform.
Because Silvery Hill is visible from all three locations, it suggests that during certain times of year, it could have been the central point of a series of simultaneous ceremonies. Avebury, West Kennet, and the sanctuary could each have taken their cue from what was going on at Silvery. What happened during those ceremonies remains a mystery, but Ronald Hutton believes there is one more piece of evidence that lends weight to the theory.
Okay, what I'd love is to have another idea in with that.
Okay.
And that is, they didn't cover the chalk rock of Silbury with anything. And so it was a shining mountain of light, a glowing hill under sun and under moonlight, so you could see it for miles.
If this theory is correct, during the time of the pagans, Silbury Hill wasn't overgrown with grass as it is today, but was a shining man-made mountain of white chalk with a spiral pathway. Anyone on it would have been visible for miles. The magnificent mound of Silbury Hill survives as one of the greatest monuments of pagan Britain. But it came from a world that would be lost forever. On the south coast of England lay another hill, the spectacular Maiden Castle. In centuries to come, it would fall to the invading army of Rome and witness the end of the ancient world of pagan Britain. Maiden Castle in southern England is the largest hill fort in Europe. In Manhattan, it would cover 10 city blocks. The defenses of this massive pagan stronghold seemed impregnable, but they were no match for the greatest fighting force in the ancient world, the Roman army. Today, only the eroded earthen ramparts remain. But for thousands of years, Maiden Castle was a military prize, fought over by warring pagan tribes from the time of Stonehenge until the end of the Iron Age, when it fell under the rule of Rome.
These earthworks are absolutely massive. We've got a great rampart there coming down to a deep ditch, coming up to another huge rampart here. And this is actually standing about 75 feet over the height of the ditch. So it's an immense amount of effort would have gone into building this thing. And it would have taken an immense amount of effort to actually charge up this slope if you were attacking the hill fort.
Normally, the weakest point of any stronghold is the entrance, but Maiden Castle was designed with a surprise in store for any invaders.
We're looking here at the western entrance to the hill fort, and if it looks like a confusing jumble of mounds, well, it would have been even more confusing to any attackers who were approaching the fort. And the idea is that people are led around in this confusing sort of maze. It makes it more difficult for them to attack.
We can now bring the defenses of Maiden Castle back to life and discover why it was considered the greatest hill fort in pagan Britain. Three concentric rings of ditches and banks surrounded Maiden Castle. On top of the final bank of chalk and earth stood a wooden palisade. A walkway along the top of the palisade allowed warriors to keep watch and served as a platform for the hill fort's main defense, the stone slingers. Two watchtowers stood either side of the entrance as added protection against enemies attempting to storm the gate. When the Romans invaded in 43 AD, Maiden Castle was occupied by the Durotriges tribe, who were overlords of much of southwestern England. Miners and iron workers, they were a powerful confederation of tribes and even issued their own coins. But they now faced the most highly trained and fearsome army of the age, an army which possessed a huge technological advantage. They used a type of crossbow called a ballista. The nearby Dorset County Museum contains evidence of its effectiveness in the remains of two pagan warriors found at the site.
There were a number of graves of Iron Age warriors, and about 10 of these people had had sword cuts to the head, severe cuts and blows all on the skulls, and one of them actually had a ballista bolt through the spine.
But to reach the defenders of Maiden Castle, the bolt must have traveled over three huge ramparts. To understand the ballista's range, historian Ronald Hutton is looking at a working replica.
How many of these machines would a Roman legion have packed?
Each legion had 60 pieces of artillery, so there would have been 60 of these ranged around the hill fort.
Until the end of the Middle Ages, the ballista was the most complicated weapon ever built. In basic terms, the weapon's bowstring is pulled back using a pair of winches and a toothed mechanism called a ratchet, giving it many times more power than simple human muscle. A bolt is then loaded and released. A ballista bolt could travel at over 110 miles per hour and had a range of up to a quarter of a mile.
Good grief, that bolt went faster than my eye could see.
The ballista allowed the Roman invaders to launch volleys of bolts into Maiden Castle from far out of range of the pagan defenders' slingshots.
When you're throwing sling stones, there's only a certain range you can manage. The Roman ballistas were able to far out distance the slings that people were used to warring with. So all of these ramparts, this great distance and height, it wasn't enough to fight the Romans.
Even from the top of the palisade, the defenders would not have had a clear view of the Roman encampment. And with a range of only 200 yards, their stone slings wouldn't even reach halfway to the Roman ballistas. The ballista was more than capable of sending a projectile over the ramparts and wooden palisade into the very heart of Maiden Castle. Death for a defender would have arrived literally as a bolt from the blue. By the middle of the first century AD, most of the remaining 50 or so hill forts had been conquered by the invading Roman legions. The lives of the pagan Britons were transformed completely by an influx of people and ideas from all over the Roman Empire. Yet even before the Roman conquest, many of pagan Britain's monuments and settlements were long forgotten memories, because the people who built them had themselves changed. The Stone Age village of Skara Brae, the Great Ring of Brodgar, and the Tomb of the Eagles had already been abandoned for many generations. The construction skills that created the summer and winter alignments at Maze Howe and Woodhenge had been lost as religions had evolved. Even Stonehenge, the greatest of all ancient pagan monuments, would become a traveler's curiosity, an enigma that would enchant and confuse scholars from the Middle Ages on. While the mysterious Silbury Hill and the great hill fort of Maiden Castle would be used by the Romans themselves for their own temples and settlements. As the